All right. So considering that the hearings in the Senate are going on when it comes to possible economic amendments for the charter, what is the overall sense of the Senate? Do we need charter change or are we open for business?
I cannot prognosticate, predict what the collective decision of the Senate would be, considering that hearings are still ongoing, and I heard that there will be hearings in other places of the country as well. So we'll just wait. We just wait for the final outcome. It will be a collective decision. But just the same, I'm glad that charter change has been a priority now, because it highlights the need to have a constitutional discussion of sorts amongst our people. Right. Nakalimutan to, eh. We're focused on right now the motives, the intent, the need, trying to figure out the why is there a need to amend the Constitution. But what is important right now is that we have a discussion collectively in terms of societal discussion.
Okay, but then you are attending these hearings. So my question is, what have you realized? I mean, during the time of former President Duterte, there were already amendments to the Public Service Act, or the PSA, the passage of the Foreign Investment Act, the Retail Trade Liberalization Act. Do we still need to make amendments to the economic provisions of the Constitution, considering these three have been passed?
I've heard arguments saying that no amendments are needed right now, based on what you just mentioned. But there are still, and I've heard arguments stating that it's not just the constitutional provisions that should be implicated, but our systems as well. For instance, the need for many signatures, the red tape, the inherent corruption, perhaps the lack of facilities, infra, electricity, et cetera, so that's answering your question. What I just learned, I learned something new, that we're still in a state of perpetual flux in terms of where should we be right now, considering that the Constitution was ratified in 1987, several decades ago. And from my records, when we ratified the 1987 Constitution, we just had a population of almost 55 million. We're now 109 million. Mm-hmm. And when we ratified the 1987 Constitution, to be exact, the date was February 2, 1987, the vote was 17.4 million in favor, 2.5 million against. So in terms of historical discussion, we're now, how can the 17.4 million Filipinos who voted in favor decide for the future of the almost 80 plus or 90 million Filipinos living today? So
I completely understand you there, but I think the bigger issue is, do they know what they want changed? I mean, I get yes. All of that, right?
Yes,
change is good. The Constitution is a living, breathing thing. It should evolve. But do they know what we need? I've been listening to the hearings. I don't know what industry is still closed.
Correct. You're correct. Perhaps
what do we need?
To be point blank, from my own personal research, I would want to have the exploitation, exploration, extraction of natural gas and oil and reserves, which are currently reserved, which has a constitutional restriction insofar as the proportionate ownership is concerned, be lifted. to enable us to exploit our mineral resources. I'm not referring to the golds. I'm referring to the potential oil and natural gas resources within the West Philippine Sea. Be open up.
All right.
So but, that's my personal feelings right now.
Yeah, but I'm curious. So let's talk about that. Right now, the Constitution allows the Philippines to contract a third party to actually exploit the natural resources in the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. But the reason the Philippines isn't doing that is because it's cautious about its diplomatic ties with China. So is the Constitution the problem? Because you can contract a Shell, a Chevron, or another foreign entity to actually exploit with the Philippines, but they are not partners.
We had the recent Supreme Court decision invalidating a joint agreement between, it's a tripartite agreement involving Philippines, Vietnam, and China because of that ownership restriction. But I also have second thoughts on that, with all due respect to the Supreme Court, specifically because we have to answer the question, will the Philippine Constitution apply in our exclusive economic zone? Do we have sovereignty then? Or do we just have sovereign rights? So these are, and then to make it clear, perhaps an amendment can be inserted as regards the national patrimony. So these are partly in answer to your question, but I'm not espousing all of the current proposed amendments. But my premise is this: there has got to be a constitutional dialogue. It has to be transparent. People would have to be educated. Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao.
All right, that's fair. Now, what was brought up in the Senate, for example, the needing of 160 plus signatures, right, to open up a power plant in the Philippines. In Singapore, they said you need 3 or less than 5. Is that an issue of the Constitution, really? Or frankly, in the Philippines, this is an issue of the ease of doing business, the principles, and LGUs following the ease of doing business. Is that the Constitution's problem?
It is not. It is not a constitutional problem. It has something to do with the implementation, but I would surmise that it has something to do with our misappreciating constitutional values. That's why I'm for education. We still don't understand our historical narrative, why we should have a constitution as a foundational framework on what we should do and embark as a nation. Palagi ko yun yung gap. So in a way, that's a constitutional issue, but not really the letters of the Constitution, but the misappreciation of what the Constitution states insofar as the public officials are concerned, who are supposed to be swearing to uphold the Constitution.
But the problem with this situation is the hearings are taking up time.
Correct.
In the end, we are spending people's money.
Correct.
We are hitting the second year of President Marcos Jr.'s term. And if our legislators are technically spending so much time, right, talking about do we need charter change without knowing what we need to change, don't we consider this a waste of time over other things that this administration should be focusing on?
Not really, because as I have said, it is a proper forum to educate those, specifically those who are not part of the 17.4 million Filipinos who ratified the current constitution, which we are talking about right now. It is a forum to perhaps make the viewers, the listeners, and all of us realize that we should have shared values based on the constitution. And it's not a waste of time. If we can achieve that, if we can have a coherent narrative insofar as the shared values are concerned, I think it would not be considered as a waste of time. It's part of the stream of our history. You mentioned a living constitution. It's a living framework telling us that we should not end where we began in 1987.
But the problem is, like, for example, the US Constitution has been amended 26 times, I believe. The Indian Constitution over 100 times, right? The Thai Constitution over 20 times. But the problem is, every time there's a suggestion to change the charter, is there's always a political motivation.
Correct. There is always a political motivation.
That's why we're not moving forward.
Because we don't trust each other.
Because it's always lawmakers wanting to either change their terms, right?
Correct.
So how then can you focus on real amendments?
I don't have the correct answer, but you mentioned the US Constitution. I think their historical narrative is correct and better than ours, because they treat the Constitution as a civil religion.
Yes, but they don't change terms in all of the amendments of the U.S. Constitution.
Yes, I'm not referring to the terms. Yeah. They don't change
terms of public officials.
I'm against that. What I'm saying is this. Perhaps the dysfunction here lies where how we treat the Constitution. If I may be allowed to quote a famous Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court. I've studied U.S. court laws several times. I'm still, modestly aside, teaching constitutional law right now. Chief Justice Warren Burger once said, we should teach the Constitution's principles. We should teach them to your children. Speak of them when sitting in your home. Speak of them when walking by the way, when lying down, and when rising up. Write them upon the door plate of your home and upon your gates. That's how they treat the Constitution. Sa atin, if you ask, have you read? You can ask your neighbor, no offense, have you read the Philippine Constitution? Baka wala. It always starts with the preamble. We, the sovereign Filipino people, it starts with the we. Tayo lahat yun eh. It has to be that inclusive. But napapag-usapan lang yung Constitution once there is a debate such as this. It's sad.
Okay. All right. Now, Senator, I wanted to ask you, with the passage of the Foreign Investment Act, you were a sitting senator when this was passed. Why do you think didn't the Philippines have more foreign direct investments after this was passed? Indonesia and Vietnam got the most last year.
The environment, perhaps, the political predictability in terms of how we do our elections, and what I've narrated a while ago, what they've been saying, our infrastructure, perhaps corruption, the unpredictability of everything, changing the rules, sometimes the implementing rules would be more than what the law provides, et cetera, et cetera. So this dysfunctional system is a continuing oscillation which provides a negative environment for investors. So that's probably the reason.
Mm-mm. So do we need economic amendments? I mean, right now under RH Bill number 6, that's coming from both houses, it's actually targeting three areas: education, advertising, and the Public Services Act?
Let me clarify that. There's a difference between the R86 of the House, which would have called for a constitutional convention, and the RH bill of the Senate, which would be acting as a constituent assembly in a regular legislative mode. So question is, perhaps your question can be the same directed to the other provision, the suspect provisions, which are situating right now in the media, the extension of term limits, additional years, etc., etc. So we answered the why. Is there a need for a constitutional amendment, constitutional reform? So, but that's probably the bottom line in all of this. Is our constitution sedimentary enough that it doesn't respond to the needs of the times? So, or are we just engaged in one constitutional moment, dialogue, which is part of our constitutional history? So it's difficult to answer that right now, because we are still engaged in an ongoing dialogue on where we want to go.
Okay, now just very quickly, when it comes to the People's Initiative, do you believe it's dead in the water?
Your exact reference to those words, perhaps it has hit a constitutional barrier of sorts, given the evolving narratives, specifically the motive, the funds involved, etc., etc. So it has, again, it can be part of my earlier description that they will end where they began.
All right. Well, on that note, I want to thank you so much, Senator Francis Tolentino, for your time today. Is there anything you'd like to add, or what we can expect from the upcoming hearings?
I suggest, I encourage the public to be vigilant, participate. More discussions should be done, not just in terms of opinions, but how the Constitution would be part of our values. The Constitution, we only have three: the flag, our Declaration of Independence, and the Constitution should be placed on a higher pedestal. It should not just be a document that is subject to political secret motivations, but it has to be a living document that would involve all of us Filipinos.
On that note, I want to thank you so much, Senator Francis Tolentino,